Accidental Champion Trilogy Box Set, Books 1 through 3, written by Jamie Davis, narrated by Stacy Gonzalez.
Dedication. To all the brave, independent women in my life, I hope Cari makes you proud. Jamie Davis. To Madison, the Mona to my Hal. C.J. Davis.
Book 1, Accidental Duelist.
Prologue. After reading the dispatch one last time, Her Imperial Majesty Empress Carina, Defender of the Realm, Warden of the Northern Reaches, Uniter of the Races, and Lady of the Crystal City, folded the heavy paper, so the broken wax seal of the Imperial Courier Service showed once more on the outside. 6 times she'd received one of these messages, and 6 times she'd sat on the throne, maintaining a visage of stone, impassive to those viewing from the outside, despite her inner emotions.
My Lord Colonel, you are quite sure all of them perished?
Yes, I'm afraid so, Your Majesty, Colonel Sharp of the Imperial Dragoons said. The ship's wreckage was found off the coast. It may have been the result of a recent storm, as the message suggests,
or what, Colonel?
There may have been raider activity in the area, Your Majesty.
Were I a betting man?
You're not paid to bet on anything. Lord Colonel,
Kenton, the Duke of Karen, snapped, inserting himself into the conversation. When she was younger, Carina might have dressed down the Duke for interrupting her family's chief bodyguard. Under the circumstances, with no one else to protect after the loss of her eldest son's family at sea, she remained silent, distracted by her thoughts and sorrow. The Duke continued,
"Please keep your reporting to the facts, and let those of us who are your betters take up the matter of deeper meaning. Were you and your vaunted dragoons better at your jobs of protecting the Imperial family, we would not have had the Crown Prince and all of his descendants on an ill-fated journey away from the protection of the capital in search of sanctuary on the west. I counseled against it at the time the plan was put in motion, and I'm still against it, even as we find ourselves having to relay such sorrowful news to Her Majesty."
Carina forced herself to push her sadness away and focus on her 2 top advisors. They looked as if they might come to blows. She couldn't afford to lose either of them to anything as stupid as a duel of honor.
Gentlemen, arguing amongst yourselves does not serve the Empire or my wishes. As much as this saddens me, on a personal level, the needs of the Empire are paramount. With the death of my eldest son, his children,
Carina took a deep breath before continuing,
and grandchildren, the question of succession is foremost on my mind. Lord Colonel, I believe that leaves my only remaining grandson, Timrin, as the sole surviving heir to the Crystal Throne. I don't suppose you know where he is at the moment.
The Lord Colonel of the Imperial Dragoons spared a brief glance away to his aide standing along the wall. Carina caught the nearly imperceptible shake of the woman's head and knew the answer before he said it.
I'm afraid young Timrin has evaded his keepers once more, Your Majesty. We are working to find him, and will spare no effort until he is recovered safe and sound. I'm sure you will do your best, Colonel.
The Duke of Karen sneered.
My only fear is your best may not be good enough. You and your dragoons are supposed to be the family's personal guard, and yet over these last 5 years, You've managed to lose every one of them to one fell disaster or another. Now you tell us you cannot find the Empress's only surviving heir. That is most unsatisfactory, Lord Colonel. Most unsatisfactory.
The Duke turned his back on the old soldier, who struggled to find words to counter the accusations leveled against him and his household troops. Duke Kenton pulled a rolled paper from inside his jacket and handed it to the Empress, where she sat on the throne. Corina reached out and took the document from him. She noted the seal of the Privy Council and suspected what it was right away. Kenton confirmed it a moment later.
Your Majesty, the members of the Privy Council have all voted on the matter and must recommend that you disband the Empress's own Imperial Dragoons at once. Not only are they a needless strain on the royal coffers, when more affordable and effective alternatives exist for your protection, their substantial forces can be better used to reinforce our army on the eastern reaches. They are mostly ceremonial anyway, and based on the most recent news, clearly serve no useful purpose as bodyguards to you and your family anymore. Who would you propose be responsible for taking over those duties, Duke Kenton?
Colonel Sharp sneered. Corina already knew the Duke's answer.
My own personal guardsmen are highly trained and are already in the Crystal City, helping the local city guardsmen maintain order in these divisive times. It would be a small matter to detail some of their number to your personal security and to secure the whereabouts of your recalcitrant grandson, Timrin, at the same time. It would require only a small fee on the Empress's part.
Corina saw Colonel Sharp's chest puff up in indignation at the slight against his troops. She raised a hand, palm outward as she spoke.
Duke Kenton, you and the Privy Council have already siphoned off most of the troops from my loyal dragoons for the war efforts to the east. You and the Council have also forestalled them from taking any new recruits. What was once a proud regiment with two battalions of mounted dragoons is now little more than a platoon of foot guards, most of them well past their prime. Now, you would have me disband them entirely? Members of the Imperial Dragoons have protected me and my family since before I took the throne.
And yet, as you said yourself, they are past their prime and have served their purpose, Kenton said. You need guardsmen who will fulfill the charge to protect you and not let every little natural disaster or mysterious coastal raider wipe out what little remains of your imperial line. It is high time you stopped holding on to old, outdated conventions and traditions rooted in past glories, long forgotten. I'll not let you disband the remaining dragoons. Under the charter you and the Privy Council forced me to sign, I'm still entitled to a minimum force of household retainers. I shall keep the ones I have. The dragoons in the Crystal City will remain here with me. That is all, my lords. You may go.
Corina held her gaze on the Duke of Karen. He glanced her way once, before turning and leaving the audience chamber with only the briefest of bows in her direction. Colonel Sharp's bow was deep and reverent in contrast as he backed toward the door. She waited until the room cleared and no one was left but her two ladies in waiting. Then the facade came down. Tears welled up in her eyes as she once more opened the letter detailing the children
and grandchildren lost in the shipwreck.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.